afternoon, everyone. Welcome to this guest lecture by Professor Zofia Kolbuszewska. We're very pleased to welcome at the European Studies Center. She's an old friend and colleague, and she is a professor of American literature at John Paul II Catholic University in Lublin, where I've just returned from last week. I think we were together at the conference at the Maria University in Lublin. We were together. Professor Kolbuszewska published extensively and is probably best known for her work on Thomas Pynch. She's a renowned expert and certainly the best known Polish Pynch scholar, someone who's published in Pynch of Notes, and someone who's organized an international conference on Thomas Pynch several years ago in Lublin. Pynch was the topic of her doctoral dissertation, and his dissertation was published in 2000. It's called The Poetics of the Chronotope in the Novels of Thomas Pynch, and it's in our library, I just checked. So if anyone is interested, I highly recommend this work. And then in 2007, she published The Purloined Child, subtitled American Identity and the Representations of Child Within American Literature, 1851-2000. And this is the second monograph that has published. Her interests also include forensic imagination, which sounds really interesting. You know, it's like detective, I guess, and nosology.
Going to talk about it today.
Right. But I mean, this is fascinating. And there are articles about Kolbuszewska if you're interested in pursuing this. And today, of course, she's talking about Neobaroque, which is also a very interesting concept that we'll hear about more in a minute. She's been repeatedly to the U.S., including Castle Fulbright, Columbia University, and also at the University of Buffalo, to the Kosciuszko Foundation, those one application. So I'm very, very pleased to have Ms. Kolbuszewska with us. Welcome, and I give the floor to you.
Well, Tomek, thank you very much. I'd like to say that I'm very grateful to Professor Baszuk for having me here. And without much ado, let's get to the topic of my presentation, which is Neo-Baroque in the 20th and 21st century American fiction. But as the notion of Neo-Baroque is hardly known, hardly familiar in Poland, I'm going to extensively introduce the topic. So I'm afraid that there will be less time left for the Neo-Baroque in the American fiction. I wanted to include a section on Gabies, about whom Professor Baszuk wrote a lot, and published a book. But unfortunately, because of the pressure of time, I decided to cut it out. I'm going to mention him as well. So, I'm going to begin my presentation with a quotation from Thomas Pynchon's The Crying of Lot 49, so published in the late 1960s, a text that will later serve as an example of how the introduction of the concept of neo-baroque opens a new perspective on the writer's attitude towards modernity. Exhausted and dejected, an allegorically androgynous character, Edith Mas, confesses that, quote, she had heard all about excluded middles. They were bad shit to be avoided, unquote. And referring to American history, she asks, quote, how had it happened here with the chances once so good for diversity, unquote. Then she goes on to observe that, quote, behind the hieroglyphic street, there will be either a transcendent meaning or only the earth. Another mode of meaning behind obvious or none, unquote. With these sentences, Pynchon anticipates in the mid-1960s the debate on the return of the Baroque in the contemporary culture, a proposition that found its expression in a series of books and texts in English or translated into English, which were published since the early 1980s. Now, with the publication of a series of articles on the New World Baroque and Neo-Baroque in the Theories and Methodology issue of PMLA, which appeared in January 2009, a debate concerning the Neo-Baroque turn in the 20th and 21st century as a complex critique of modernity has entered a new stage. The methodology developed in the field of Latin American studies has been extended to embrace the analysis of any cultural formation or cultural formations that have emerged at the site of the clash between centripetal, so directed to the center, centripetal, imperial, and colonial administrations and colonized, but not entirely modernized peripheries with a tendency for centrifugal, that is, directed outside, away from the center, so centrifugal cultural development. These new formations are dynamic constructs governed by hybridity, liquidity, and transgression of cultural categories, and therefore prone to all kinds of conflicting interpretations and productive misreadings. The Neobaroque, as a paradigm, marks the return of an interest in and rediscovery of Baroque sensibility, which underpins contemporary cultural production, politics, and technology. Anne Munster, a German scholar, believes that, quote, thinking through the Baroque as an unfolding, ongoing event allows us to see its virtual and actual relations to computational culture, that is digital culture, and therefore to understand culture according to new modalities, unquote. Now here, I present a few books, publications on the Baroque and Neo-Baroque. You have got the kind of the brackets because some scholars prefer to, and I'm going to explain it later on, prefer to refer to the Baroque poetics or return of the Baroque poetics. Some of the scholars, however, draw on this neo-Baroque paradigm. Now, I would like to show you the publication by a Polish scholar, Paweł Stachura from Poznań University. He was interested in the return of the emblem and the Baroque iconology, and he was exploring this iconography, Baroque iconography, in American popular literature, visual literature. So these are the publications. You can see quite a few of them, and were all published they have been published since 1980s. Some American modernist and postmodernist writers take up Leibnizian vision of the world as a folding and unfolding continuum, explored by Gilles Deleuze in the book Retitled The Fold. The French philosopher describes the fold as, quote, a flexible or elastic body that still has coherent parts that form a fold, such that they are not separated into parts of parts, but are rather divided to infinity in smaller and smaller folds that always retain a certain cohesion. Thus, a continuous labyrinth is not a line dissolving into independent points, as flowing sand might dissolve into grains, but resembles a sheet of paper divided into infinite folds, or crumpled sheets of paper, divided into infinite folds or separated into bending movements, each one determined by the consistent or conspiring surroundings. So this is Gilles Deleuze's definition of the fold. And commenting in Materializing New Media, Embodiment in Information Aesthetics, on our contemporary digital habitat, Anna Munster, whom I already mentioned, points to an affinity with the historical Baroque, which, quote, can, in its own time, be seen as marking out topography in which the relations of connection and difference between living bodies, material objects, scientia, that is the content of the mind, and the passions formed a mesh of enfolded territories. The Baroque morphology of fold reemerges in surrealism, so surrealist art, as well as in scientific concern with non-linear processes, such as theory of catastrophe and geometry of fractals. American writers, such as, among others, Juno Barnes, William Gaddis, Thomas Pynchon, and Conrad McCarthy, also dramatize and stage what William Eggington refers to as modernity's particular problem of thought, whose aesthetic counterpart was first the historical Baroque. The fundamental problem of modernity and its greatest challenge is connected with the terms of inquiry of any kind. The Russian scholar Mikhail Epstein observes that, quote, in the widest meaning of the term modern, This project is a quest for and a reconstruction of an authentic, higher, essential reality to be found beyond the conventional arbitrary sign systems of culture. Over centuries, efforts to come to terms with this problem of getting to this higher essential reality have resulted in, or if this reality, a question whether this reality exists at all, have resulted in the emergence of modern epistemology most conspicuously exemplified in the thought of Immanuel Kant in the 18th century. The world can be approached by the subject of knowledge only through a veil of appearances. To express the complexity, theatricality, melancholy, disruption, and deception, the Baroque and Neo-Baroque deploy the images of library and Kunstkammer, labyrinth and ruin. About Kunstkammer later, I'm going to say a little more later. These images serve as auto-referential models embedded in texts and works of art, that is, mise en abîme, as well as functioning as a response to and manifestation of the modern problem of thought. That is, once again, a question of how to know which one out of the multiplicity of realities and experience is the real world, if any. And of course, also to similar political and economical situation, that is, the reality of global crisis. The inception of the debate of the concept of neo-baroque can be traced to late 19th century art historical studies of Heinrich Wölfflin, whose ideas contribute to the surge of interest in the 1920s and 1930s in Baroque as a type of sensibility and style and as a historical period. The concept of Baroque is engaged by both universalist historians of ideas, such as Oswald Spengler, Wilhelm Waringer, and Eugenio Dors, and novelists and poets, such as, for instance, William Faulkner, Djuna Barnes, T.S. Eliot, and Octavio Paz. In the mid-20th century, Cuban writers and poets Alejo Carpentier, José Lezama Lima, and Severo Sardut theorize the new Baroque and Neo-Baroque. Michel Foucault and Gilles Deleuze consider Baroque reason, aesthetics, and philosophy in connection with a critique of modernity, while in The Origin of German Tragic Drama, originally published in 1928, but very influential, after its second edition appeared in 1977, Walter Benjamin, or Walter Benjamin, locates modernity's roots in Baroque and redefines Baroque allegory as a modern genre per se. Referring to Benjamin's conception of the relationship between modernity and Baroque and to his view of the French poet Baudelaire as both a critic of modernity and its epitome, Christine Bucci-Glucksmann studies Baroque reason as the embodiment of the repressed modernist aesthetics. On the other hand, Omar Calabrese explores the semiotics of neo-Baroque and considers it a cultural mode that cuts across the modern versus postmodern divide. The theorist José Antonio Maraval averts in turn that his interest lies in Baroque understood strictly as a historical period, whereas Lois Parkinson Zamora, known probably before as a scholar concerned with the magical realism. So she went from magical realism to neo-Baroque. Whereas Lois Parkinson Zamora, Monica Kaup, and William Eggington view, quote, the historical Baroque as part of a complex that includes both the colonial and neo-Baroque periods. End quote. Eggington even proposes a neologism, colonial-Baroque, to designate this complex, but the term doesn't acquire any traction and is soon abandoned. Neo-Baroque is characterized by a tension between centripetal forces of central power controlling the periphery and centrifugal forces and events and expressions of local, that is peripheral, specificity, imagination, and invention between major and minor strategies. Now, what are these? By emphasizing the neo-Baroque strategy of becoming minor, Monica Kaup and William Eggington continued Deleuze's project of, quote, recuperating an underrepresented or minor undercurrent of modernist thought, unquote. Kaup and Eggington draw on the discussion of the minor literature in Kafka, Toward a Minor Literature, a book by Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari. The philosophers emphasize that, quote, a minor literature does not come from minor language. It is rather that which a minority constructs within a major language. Unquote. The three characteristics of minor literature are the deterritorialization of language, the connection of the individual to political immediacy, and the collective assemblage of enunciation, meaning there are no masters or canons. Major strategy in the Baroque and Neo-Baroque assumes a positive answer to the question of what is beyond appearances and claims it is the truth, the plenum, to be found beyond the veil. Major strategy declares representation to be that truth, thus drawing the spectator's attention away from the frames, marking and revealing representation as just it, an artifice. Minor strategy, on the other hand, takes the major strategy at face value, amplifies it, taking it to its absurd extremes. Representation is thus performative and not referential. Minor strategy cuts off the representative relation. A copy becomes liberated from the original, while the means of representation becomes an end in itself. Minor strategy is the aesthetic and strategy of growth, change, proliferation, excess, and disruption. This amounts to renouncing pretensions to metaphysical knowledge and an affirmation of embodiment, materiality, and finitude, where existence is regarded as expression of itself, pointing only to itself and to no reality beyond itself. Therefore, Neobaroque sensory experience is, perhaps paradoxically, always already artificial. The concept of theatricality of space is underlying the Neobaroque experience, where the perceiver is analogous to a spectator in a theater who synthesizes raw data and organizes his knowledge through the medium of the stage and its characters. As Gluckstein observes, quote, Baroque reason, with its theatricization of existence and its logic of ambivalence, is not merely another reason within modernity. Above all, it is the reason of the other, of its overbrimming excess. In Mutti Glucksmann's reflection, quote, the feminine arises constantly as a challenge to existing social theory and practice when the male principle dominates to the exclusion of the female principle, unquote. Thus, Baroque reason is an expression of the theatricized femininity defying its repression. Postmodern sensibility, a sensibility of the spectacle, can be considered the neo-baroque minor strategy inasmuch as it is regarded as remaining in tension with major modernist aesthetics. William Eggington warns, however, that during the times of historical baroque, quote, mobile desires and identifications, unquote, were bridled by the emerging centralizing mechanisms of the state powers through employing the devices of spectacle and strategies of fascination. Well, where do we know them from? Proliferation of entertainment and spectacle. Referring to an otherwise brilliant analysis of neo-baroque artistic strategies in postmodern entertainment and new media, put forward by Angela Ndalianis in Neo-Baroque Aesthetics and Contemporary Entertainment, Eggington warns that, quote, this is a lesson that is easily forgotten in the move to baptize the aesthetics of postmodernism as the neo-baroque. So, not necessarily all postmodern is minor strategy. Neo-Baroque can also be at the service of the powers that be. Severo Sardou observes that Baroque language is in frustrated search for the partial object, the objet petit a, the lack, the kind of lack. The minor strategy does not treat the lack as, quote, derivative of an eternal plenitude separated from us by temporality. Rather, it fills out the finitude of language and inhabits it and the world as essentially lacking. So, celebrates the lack rather than being afraid of it. For all objects are by definition partial, and all searches by definition frustrated. Therefore, neo-baroque language of abundance is a language of insufficiency, where horror of vacuity, so horror of vacuity, is prompted by the sense of void underneath the excess, and also can be traced to the lack of security, political security. Butchie Glucksmann points out that, quote, the destiny of the Baroque form is directed toward an always unstable and ephemeral state, which constantly solicits a double and doubling gaze. In Neo-Baroque, the counterpoint structure of historical vision is transmitted by the imago, an image created out of a dispersed identity, legitimized by the center and the elements of the peripheral unknown, which all of them, which morph into a new dissident identity, a hybrid identity in constant flux, oscillating between the position of a subject and an object. By simultaneously serving as a point of convergence and ordering of knowledge, and its dispersal, the imago occupies a paradoxical space in the Baroque conceptual model where, quote, the truth is contained and produced by the illusion that conceals it, unquote. Now, it does not mean the truth is illusion, rather the other way around. The illusion is truth. It is a different way of putting what the minor strategy does. Eckinghorn explicates this view by pointing out that imago functions like the frame in the trompe-l'oeil, this illusionistic painting, for instance, in Baroque churches. Quote, it marks the illusory border separating the viewer from a promised glory in a non-existent space beyond. You try to get to the wall because you think there is a space beyond. No, there is no space. You just are by the wall. The double articulated nature of the neo-baroque, its centrifugality inseparable from its centripetality, arises from the fact that the imago is situated at the point where the eye of the beholder, the hegemonic beholder, the beholder wielding power, which defines, so the center which defines his or her I, that is identity, clashes with the gaze of the other, directed at him or her from the colonial peripheries, by a feminized, the gaze of a feminized subaltern. The image of the self from that point, so in the imago, constitutes a radically different perspective than the view onto that point. Thus, the Baroque and Neo-Baroque strategy for facing the multiplicity of perspectives and impossibility of adhering to one single and universal truth is to sort out inconsistencies and into parallel worlds, and I'm going to show in a moment how it works in visual arts. The epistemological question turns into an ontological quandary. The Maltese poet Fausto Maestrale, character in Thomas Pynchon's V, from 1963, the first novel, Pynchon's first novel, expresses this awareness of the subaltern's dual hybrid identity conveyed by the imago by remarking that, quote, perhaps British colonialism has produced a new sort of being, a dual man aimed two ways at once, unquote. Now, I believe that a scene from a Polish, of the 1964, the neo-baroque film directed by Wojciech Jerzy Haas, Zaragoza manuscript, so Rękopis na Wzorze Zaragoście, illustrates well the operating of the imago. A captain of the Spanish Emperor's Walloon Guards, Alphonse van Borden, on his way to Madrid, is misled by demonic forces and repeatedly comes back to the same haunted mountain inn where he is not unwillingly, of course, seduced by two girls claiming to be his cousins. Being representatives of the repressed Marano and Morisco minorities, they question the mythical purity of Spanish blood and obsession of Spanish culture, thus making van Worden realize that his repressed identity is an impure hybrid. This awareness gives rise to the imago conveyed by the cinematic means in the film. And here we are, this is the scene in... Sorry for the ratio. Now pay attention to how it's visually rendered. So, gypsy, Muslim, and Jewish girls, I mean, their origin is not clear, claiming they are cousins of Angola. So van Borden is not just a proud Spanish guy, he has got the tainted blood in his veins. Now this hybrid is scary, this hybrid identity can be scary. Okay. Now back to our presentation. Okay, actually, sorry for this, I should Okay, now there's another thing I wanted to say about the Neobaroque, and this is its surprising quality. So, hybridity of the Neobaroque and internal tension between the major and minor Baroque strategies arise from the many complex social, ethnic, cross-cultural and religious confrontations and resentments of the colonial experience at the margins of imperial powers' territories, an experience constitutive of modernity. Nevertheless, Neo-Baroque theory, especially in its New World Baroque guise, is a poetic appeal for restitution and possesses a conciliatory capacity, as it points to the flow of cultural influences from the margins and their assimilation by the so far homogenizing discourse of the center, which is beautifully presented in Peter Greenaway's adaptation of Shakespeare's The Tempest, and which is about the brave new world, obviously, where indeed, in a metaphorical scene, the colonial subaltern, Caliban, redeems the cultural legacy of the dominating political and cultural center by saving a volume in Shakespeare's plays from disintegrating in water when the books are thrown away.
This is a thick printed volume of plays dated 1623. There are 35 plays in the book and room for one more. 19 pages have been left for its inclusion, right at the front of the book, just after the preface.
Now, this film is also an example of great Neo-Baroque poetics.
And this is
visual
the 36th play, The Tempest. Whilst all the other volumes have been drowned and destroyed, we still
and here
have
got Caliban saving the volume of Shakespeare's
plays. Simply fish from the sea.
Okay, so this is good, and now can we continue with the presentation? Sorry for the disruption. Okay, so now I'm proceeding to the American literature part of my presentation. Neal Stephenson's trilogy, The Baroque Cycle, published in the years 2003 to 2004, explicitly engages the historical Baroque and Baroque poetics. When asked about his choice of the historical period and cultural sensibility reflected in the cycle, he responded, "Why Baroque? Because it is set in the Baroque and it is Baroque," unquote. Not unlike Walter Benjamin, the writer sees the roots of the contemporary world in the 17th century. The Baroque cycle's complex narrative unfolds actual historical facts and fictitious events, historical personages and fictitious characters, actual geography and fantastic lands. Stephenson is interested in British history of the 17th and 18th centuries, global history, and the nascence of modern science. The novels of the cycle provide an insight into the operation of global networks, secret societies, encrypted information and cryptology, as well as the occult. Stephenson's application of minor strategy thus consists in giving expression to what David L. Martin refers to as curious visions of modernity. Now, this is Martin's book, Curious Visions of Modernity. In his book, Curious Visions of Modernity, Enchantment, Magic, the Sacred, Martin points out that, quote, although scientific rationality would come to define its knowledge claims against a series of heterogeneous elements described as mere superstitious irrationality, and proclaim its transparent surface, a surface to be free of the taint of the heterogeneous, such was not the case. So, okay. Now, in introducing the character of Enoch Root, a network of application super user, so Root as the super user, Enoch now referring to the apocryphal speaker of angelic languages, Stephenson, by means of a fold traversing time, links the Baroque and the contemporary Neo-Baroque, thus fulfilling Anne Munster's hope that one would appeal, quote, to the Baroque in the context of contemporary productions of self, embodiment and artwork, particularly those productions hinging upon the the interface of form between corporeal reality and informatic code. Interestingly, the writer joins the period at the turn of the 17th and 18th century when, quote, a scene of amazing spectacles is transformed into a scene of knowledge, unquote, with the early 21st century when the scene of knowledge is fading into a scene of the spectacle, thus redeeming the early modern heterogeneity and curiosity. Okay, now I'm jumping to Duna Barnes's in Duna Barnes's clearly autobiographical knighthood, so I'm not actually progressing chronologically. In Duna Barnes's clearly autobiographical knighthood, you are going to see in a moment why this connection. In Duna Barnes's clearly autobiographical knighthood, as well as in Lady's Almanac, the Baroque iconography of martyrdom, with its characteristic excess of the images of tears, hearts, blood, and severed limbs, sanctifies ecstatic suffering and makes possible the creation of stylized representations of torment as a compensation of melancholy. Modeled on the Baroque ecstasy of Bernini's Santa Teresa, the suffering of Barnes's lesbian characters is juxtaposed with the loquacity of the doctor, a paragon of the early modern melancholia. Monica Coe points out that there is a, quote, non-efficient, wasteful, and unbalanced relationship between events, fewer traumatic, and narration, superabundant, in knighthood. The Baroque excess and artificiality of Barnes' style can be identified as minor strategy, which serves to reveal and undermine the major strategy manifesting itself, quote, as the realist truth claims of turn-of-the-century sexological discourse and challenge the scientific authority of its delineation of homosexual identities as pathological and degenerative, unquote. So the quasi-scientific and scientific are the link here between the Stevenson and Barnes. Well, I'm making this link. Knighthood relies on, even as it perverts, medical and evolutionary tropes for sexual alterity. Barnes takes much pleasure in ironically redeploying early 20th century sexual politics. In Knighthood, I'm quoting now from Cowper, in Knighthood Barnes denaturalizes and dismantles the disciplinary authority of language and society. Now, here is the cutout section on William Gaddis, but instead of discussing Gaddis' recognitions in the perspective of Neo-Baroque, I'm referring you to an outstanding, brilliant book by our former doctoral student, Małgorzata Miciuła. Look at the title of her pun in the title of her book, Holes in the Eyes, where she links the visuality with the formation of identity as the Neo-Baroque trope. And so I do recommend the book. I hope that the book is in your library. If not, I'm going to donate the book.
I think it might be.
Okay. And now I'm going to proceed to do the discussion of Thomas Pynchon and his visions of femininity. The vision of femininity, which emerged from Thomas Pynchon's early works, bespeak the melancholy character of commodified objects, as discussed by Walter Benjamin, while female characters, to use Bucci Glucksmann's diction, represent allegories of modernity. Yet, not unlike Duna Barnes's female characters, their participation in minor strategy is marked by gender inversions. The protean cyborg, the demonic woman V, is dismantled when masquerading as the bad priest, while the very name of Oedipa Mas, the protagonist of The Crying of Blood 49, invokes the figure of the androgyn. We know Oedipus. Now she is Oedipa, a female character. Thus, despite accusations of sexism, Pynchon's critique of modernity ranges from undermining its sexual politics through restoring to the center the displaced, erased, marginalized, oppressed, and peripheral otherness, to embracing pre-modern regimes, like Stevenson, or Stevenson like Black Pynchon, to embracing pre-modern regimes of knowledge based on analogy, sympathy, correspondence, and similarity as tools of cognition and principles structuring the world. In his novels, the writer celebrates the socially handicapped, colonial subjects, and human refuse of the modern capitalist bureaucratic systems while investigating the commodification of the animate that leads to their fetishizing the inanimate. In the crying of Lot 49, Edipa Mas is transfixed by a painting of the Spanish surrealist painter Remedios Varo, really or actually existing, one of the four internal models, misona beings, or allegories of the novel, which depicts girls kept captive in a tower where they embroider a tapestry representing reality. Oedipus' philosophical inquiry in the novel is similar to modernity's problem of thought delineated by Editor. Is there anything beyond appearances, beyond representation, beyond the terrestrial mantle embroidered by the girls? Oedipus experiences horror, vacui, and vertigo at the thought that there might not be anything beneath the tapestry. She experiences sublime terror when watching the picture. Aptly, the question of the sublime and the title of the novel point the reader to Immanuel Kant. Immanuel Kant's critique of judgment, more precisely to its section, surprise, surprise, 49. Okay. So, and especially to the note 2 in the section 49, where the veil of Isis, the embodiment of nature, is mentioned. Perhaps nothing more sublime was ever said, and no sublimer thought ever expressed than the famous inscription on the temple of Isis, I am all that is and that was and that shall be, and no mortal hath lifted my veil. However, as Jakub Rogozinski explains, there is no reality beyond the veil, just as in Minor Strategy, which enjoys representation for its own sake. It is the veil itself which is to be celebrated as reality. In the ordeal of the sublime, the ancient opposition between sensible and supersensible is unsettled. The third critique, that is the critique of judgment, implies another thought of the supersensible, which does not hide behind the veil of Isis, but weaves the texture of this veil, which does not reside beyond the sensible, but lies this side of it, as its substratum or its reverse. The sublime is the announcement of this end, the promise of community. In Pynchon's novel, Oedipa is faced with the four possible answers to her inquiry, one of which, that it is of no consequence what there might be beyond appearances, because it is more important to care for the materiality here and now. So one of these answers coincides with an articulation offered by the Neobaroque Minor Strategy, and is reflected in Oedipa's discovery and care of those disinherited and excluded from the success of the America of the early 1960s. Of course, we know that this is a success in the quotation marks. In La Folie de Voir, that is, Madness of Seeing, Bucci Glucksmann defines the Baroque eye, as an anamorphic gaze. It allows for a principle of uncertainty that is not merely in the image, but must be located at its foundation. A monstrous representation or a distorted and deformed projection of an image onto a surface renders a picture which only from a certain point of view appears to have proportions consistent with regularly constructed, mostly central perspectives. The logic of anamorphosis, such as the famous representation of a deformed skull in the foreground of Hans Holbein's painting, and you can see how we are supposed to look at the painting to see the skull. The logic of anamorphosis, such as the famous representation of a deformed skull in the foreground of Hans Holbein's painting The Ambassadors, or the catoptric, that is mirror, reconstruction of the portrait of the King Charles I beheaded in 1649, are invested in revelation as much as obfuscation. Either it is impossible to look at the picture from two different viewpoints simultaneously, or the image coalesces, so is reconstructed around an empty place marked with a skull. So an emptiness, the vacuum. Anamorphosis is an allegory of vision with a capital V, as Bucci Glucksmann's remarks. By revealing the dark side of representation, anamorphosis proves an excellent strategy for capturing otherness. It proves to be excellent minor strategy. Indeed, anamorphic images teach us that it is possible, quote, to look at the margins of our own visual field insofar as we are willing to marginalize our point of view, unquote. David Castillo emphasizes the ineluctably political dimension of employing certain forms of the anamorphic perspective as a trope, which not only, quote, reveals the arbitrariness and incompleteness of any total view, unquote, but also engages the dark side of anchoring points of Lacanian symbolic, that is, the culture. So it engages the dark side of anchoring points from the margins inhabited by those who are excluded from the social and fantasy. Pynchon's critique of Western modernity, in V, departs from interrogating such set of coordinates or anchoring points, that is, the notion of technological progress made manifest, among other things, in the subjugation of nature and matter, like in materiality. The subjugation is possible owing to the victorious emergence from the early modern epistemological struggles of the view of matter as inanimate and mute, and of lower, i.e. non-human nature, as soulless. Regarded as anamorphoses, V shows, or the book, the novel, shows affinities with Holbein-like anamorphic painting in that it juxtaposes incommensurate, though complementary, outlooks. Herbert Stenzel represents the world to himself in a paranoid way by means of enacting imaginary patterns stenciled onto reality. Benny Profane is a human yo-yo traversing space chaotically by sheer inertia when pushed by other characters literally or metaphorically. Emblematic of the Lacanian real, Profane is a schlemiel who typifies all this inherited and preterite, Pynchon's term for the passed over, underprivileged and forgotten by history, the preterite. His is a vision, so Benny's, is a vision of the entropic world, the realm of the inanimate, where things are disconnected in the state of ruin and decay. In anamorphically juxtaposing Stenzel's and Profane's visions of history, Pynchon thus animates what Butch Glucksmann designates as the psychic theater, which is, quote, directly linked to the theater of the Soma, stage in allegories. In this theater, the female body is, quote, by turns divested of affect, fantasized as fragment, mannequin, machine, skeleton, and then over-invested with the fascination of lyrical proximity, unquote. Stenzel's desire for the origin, for the mother, is enacted in his psychic theater as a succession of episodes referred to as impersonations, or forcible dislocations of personality, which coincide with stages in the life of an enigmatic, demonic woman called V, and provide an insight into V's avatar's horrible journey throughout the traumatic colonial history of the West. His desire, the Stenzel's desire, dramatizes these allegorical phantasms. Okay. A street corner of Via del Purgatorio and Via dell'Inferno in Florence, a place between hell and purgatory, familiar from Baudelaire's poem Allegory, is the point of V's departure on her adventures, which, according to another character, we already have met the character, the Maltese poet Fausto Maestral's real relation, and with the dismemberment of V, masquerading as the bad priest. Although Stenzel is convinced that V continues her existence as an ever technologically more advanced cyborg. Stenzel imagines V, at the age of 76, as having skin radiant with the bloom of some new plastic, both eyes glass, but now containing photoelectric cells, connected by silver electrodes to optic nerves of purest copper wire, and leading to a brain exquisitely wrought as a diode matrix could ever be. Solenoid relays would be her ganglia, servo actuators move her flawless night limbs, hydraulic fluid be sent by platinum heart pump through the butyrate veins and arteries. Perhaps, and Stenzel on occasion could have as vile a mind as any of the crew, even a complex system of pressure transducers located in the marvelous vagina of polyethylene, etc., etc. Yet, the dismantling of V destroys a crowning phantasm of modernity as a utopian Kunstkammer of Baconian New Atlantis. So modernity itself as a Kunstkammer of New Atlantis, as presented by Francis Bacon. It is worth noting that early modern collections of curiosities went by the name of Cabinets of Curiosities, or Wunder and Kunstkammer. The object displayed in those collections were to demonstrate synchronic and diachronic relationships between natural formations, ancient sculptures, works of art, and machines. The culmination of the historical development of the Kunstkammer from the 16th to the 18th century and the highlight of any collection at a particular moment of time were mechanical toys imitating life and later mechanical dolls and human-like automatons. Now, there are different types of Kunst- and Wunderkammers. Here are kind of smaller ones, more kind of the artistic nature. In his writings, Francis Bacon developed an idea of regaining paradise and Adamic knowledge of nature, the study of which Wunder and Kunstkammer facilitated. So he believed that this knowledge can be regained through progress, understood as the evolution of man in technology. Interestingly, V in itself a Wunderkammer, so V itself as the cyborg is a Wunderkammer, a Kunstkammer. She has a collection consisting of organic parts, inventions, mechanisms, and curiosities such as the comb, so for combing your hair, depicting crucifixion. She bespeaks the inherent ruin of the arch dream of modernity, that of the, once again, New Atlantis as a technological utopia, and that of subjugating the other. Although the process of gradual transformation of V into a cyborg might seem like a regress from full life into mechanical life-likeness, V, as a female, emblematic of the mother, the ultimate uncanny, as Freud would say, end of nature, is mockingly classified, however, by Pynchon as belonging in the same category as muted matter, the inanimate. Repressed, now, about the inanimate, repressed in the world of stencil, the living inanimate, so something which our culture doesn't want to think of, the matter as animated, the living inanimate stages its uncanny return in the entropic, catastrophic world of Benny Profane. Now, progress, as Walter Benjamin reflects, consists in, quote, in the eternal return of the catastrophe, unquote. As the generalized mirror stage and a decadent Saturnian history of mourning and melancholia, this is from a quote from Richard Glitzman, Pynchon's V is an allegory of modernity. In rethinking and rewriting the history of the American Southwest, so in other words, employing the minor strategy vis-a-vis the American historiography, so in rethinking and rewriting the history of the American Southwest and the American-Mexican border in Black Meridian or the evening redness in the West, Cormac McCarthy relies on interrogating the limits of the idealization of the frontier myth by attentively, painstakingly and seemingly dispassionately portraying, quote, visions of the frenzy of destruction in which all earthly things collapse into a heap of ruins. So now I'm going to quote from the Black Meridian. In the room was a wooden table with a few clay pots, and along the back wall lay remains of several bodies, one a child, another fragment. He went on with one of the protagonists. He went on through the sacristy into the church again and got his saddle. The facade of the building bore an array of saints in their niches, and they had been shot up by American troops trying their rifles. The figures shorn of ears and noses and darkly mottled with lead marks oxidized upon the stone. The huge carved and paneled doors hung wet on their hinges, and a carved stone virgin held in her arms a headless child. Not only does McCarthy dwell in detail on the descriptions of ruins and dead bodies in the language of poetical excess, but his poetic images of annihilation match his concern and anxiety about the erasure of any material traces of traumatic history following the destruction and the ensuing erosion and final disappearance of the rubble and decomposing bodies in the relentless climate of the southwestern desert. Now, all about her, the dead lay with their peeled skulls like polyps, bluely wet or luminescent melons cooling on some mesa of the moon. In the days to come, the frayed black rebuses of blood in those sands would crack and break and drift away, so that in the circuit of few suns, all trace of the destruction of these people would be erased. The desert wine would sop their ruins, and there would be nothing, nor ghost nor scribe to tell to any pilgrim in his passing how it was that people had lived in this place and in this place died. McCarthy's style brings out and celebrates horror vacuity arising in the wake of the dispersal and annihilation of the historical and the cultural, and their subsequent fading into nature as a result of the violent encounters of cultures in the southwestern borderlands. The writer's concern is simultaneously articulated in the formal excess of his poetics of the lurid and a melancholy acknowledgement of nothingness. Judge Holden, a demonic protagonist of McCarthy's novel, keeps entering in his notebook observations, reflections, and sketches pertaining to the landscape, natural objects, and artifacts he encounters throughout his journey across the Southwest, thus turning the notebook into microcosm, representing a macrocosm of the experienced and scrutinized reality. His procedure is, however, very peculiar. Not only does he kill or otherwise contribute to the demise of all creatures that come his way, but he also destroys all the objects he handles after carefully and meticulously entering them in the little notebook whose Kunstkammer character makes it an allegory of the universe. Lastly, he set before him the footpiece from a suit of armor, so an old, probably 17th or 16th or 17th century armor, hammered out in a shop in Toledo 3 centuries before, a small steel tapadero frayed and shelled with rot. This, the judge sketched in profile and in perspective, citing the dimensions in his neat script, making margin loads. When he had done, he took up the little foot guard and turned it in his hand and studied it again, and then he crushed it into a ball of foil and pitched it into the fire. He gathered up other artifacts and cast them also into the fire. Then he sat with his hands cupped in his lap, and he seemed much satisfied with the world as if his counsel had been sought in its creation. The judge cherishes a mistaken conviction that the act of representing reality will provide him with a means of its limitless control. Whatever exists, he said, whatever in creation exists without my knowledge exists without my consent, he said. And yet, everywhere upon the earth are pockets of autonomous life. Autonomous. In order for it to be mine, nothing must be permitted to occur upon it save by my dispensation. And the companion remarks, I don't see what that has to do with catching birds. And the judge answers, the freedom of birds is an insult to me. I'd have them all in zoos. By destroying the original objects of his representations, the judge erases the signatures of the unknown, of that which finds its expression in the embodiment and materiality of the world. He thereby usurps the power of a signator, which results, however, in the production of lesser signatures, i.e. of lower ontological power, bereaved of their materiality, I mean his entries in the notebook. Yet, as Walter Benjamin points out, the ruins, rubble, and the most fragmented, the most defunct and dispersed, quote, reveal the limit set upon the allegorical contemplation, rather than its ideal quality, unquote, and continues, quote, allegory, of course, thereby loses everything that was most peculiar to it, the secret, privileged knowledge, the arbitrary rule in the realm of dead objects, the supposed infinity of the world without hope, unquote. This quotation from Benjamin shows that contrary to the view held by most critics, the last word in the novel does not belong to Judge Holden, who, quote unquote, says that he will never die. If the fact that it is the often overlooked epilogue that really ends the novel, if this fact is taken into account, then it is possible to dispute David Holloway's statement that, quote, for all its quite stunning deconstructions of Holden's claim to force the unity of existence, there is little doubt as to who or what remains as a dominant force at the end of Blood Meridian, unquote. Now, here is the quote from the epilogue. I'm going to read just the part of it. On the plain behind, a man making holes in the prairie, are the wanderers in search of bones and those who do not search. And they move haltingly in the light like mechanisms whose movements are monitored with escapement and pallets so that they appear, escapement and pallet are kind of parts of machines, controlling the range of movement. With escapement and pallet so that they appear restrained by prudence of reflectiveness, which has no inner reality, and they cross in their progress one by one the track of hogs that runs to the rim of the visible ground, and it seems less the pursuit of some continuance than the verification of a principle, a validation of sequence and causality, as if each round and perfect hole, etc., etc. To the extent that it is discontinuous with the plot of the novel, the epilogue functions in the vein of Walter Benjamin as, quote, one of the images of the sequence that stands out. The image of apotheosis, as different in kind, and gives mourning at one and the same time, at one and the same time, the cue for its entry and its exit, unquote. Thus, in presenting a defamiliarized image of people moving over the plain, McCarthy asserts in the epilogue the redemptive, if melancholic, power of unconscious materiality of the Kleist-like mechanical movement, its remaining in excess of the judge's allegorizing. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so now if you have any comments, questions, protests, you are welcome to express yourself.
So maybe I could just begin. No one wants to say anything at this point. But thank you very much. This was fascinating. And I think that it might be good if we, if you could sort of like maybe go back to some of the points that we're making and just go over them again for us and help us to make the connections that you were making. So I have two such points at this moment. That I'd like to ask about. One is that moment when you talk about it's a brilliant, of course, it's a brilliant connection that you're making to section 49 and God's critique and this ISIS temple. That's wonderful. My first question is about that moment that when you talk about Pynchon's day. And the figure of the and so on, and about the inanimate, and about how nature and also this figure of maternity is kind of turned inanimate. And so my very simple question is, if we're going to read this moment in Pynchon, as I think you're suggesting, as being somehow a kind of feminist moment, surprisingly, or maybe at least a kind of
Okay, I wouldn't say, you see, I think that's the problem usually critics, whether readers have with Pynchon.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say it's feminist.
What would you say?
I would say that, you see, that's the, he's trying to, he is questioning the sexual politics of the, of modernity, but in Baudelairean vein, and it's really difficult to treat Baudelaire as kind of a feminist critic of modernity, even if he is critiquing modernity, doing himself what modernity does. Because I think in V, Pynchon takes up Baudelairean vision of the commodified female as prostitute, and that's his, Baudelairean vision. He puts together the prostitute, lesbian, mannequin, doll, okay, and believes that they behave like puppets on a stage of a theater. So I wouldn't believe that this is the way the feminist would approach. But I think what he's trying to do, he's inverting, taking to the extremes, the bourgeois visions of sexuality. Okay, so after Baudelaire, of course, he's also mocking Baudelaire. That's important too. Of course, we have not. I suppose we could devote the whole seminar to V alone, and the seminar could last 2 semesters. Okay? So it's very interesting to it would be very interesting to show how Pynchon is actually mocking everybody, even himself. And I suppose very often the critics who accuse or level accusations of his of sexism do not take into account this baroque multiplicity of levels. He works like his texts are very much like baroque poems, which are based on conceit. Like I would compare his text, even fiction, to metaphysical poetry. It works the same way metaphysical poetry, like let's take Donne or Marvel or whichever one of the metaphysical poets. So because of this multiplicity of levels, some critics stop at some levels. And I'm afraid that it might be the case that you, like in Freudian interpretation of dreams, you might try to get to the bottom and you wouldn't. And so you might be lost in the levels of interpretation. So sometimes you stop at what you have got on the surface, and on the surface is something which might be offensive. And that's very often what nowadays. I mean, just last year in Athens we had a International Pynchon Week. Which was devoted to the rereading of Pynchon's sexual politics. And quite a few papers were devoted to rereading the V for it. V. Because from V was interpreted very often in terms of fetish and kind of the fetish discourse. But once again, it was. And it's, yes, actually some of the approaches to V as fetish were actually developed from the feminist position. True, I forgot about this.
So what I would to ask also is, if we have this, I mean, and thank you for this clarification about Baudelaire, that you, and I think, I mean, that makes sense, but would you say that there is a kind of, I mean, or I guess there is, but I mean, how would you talk about a kind of, you know, the father's side here, the paternalistic or the, you know, the, I mean, the stencil, obviously, right?
I would believe that first of all, stencil. You know what stencil is? Like, you know, it's a form with which you sort of create ready-made images. Yeah? So basically, stencil is like, you know, a representative of the Lacanian symbolic. And he is the representative of course, he, on the one hand, he is representative of Lacanian symbolic, but on the other hand, if we looked at him from the Kristeva's point of view, then we would see that he is actually on search of the object, which is lost in the symbolic. So, of course, he's on the constant search for his father, but in fact, he's in constant search for the love of his mother. However, whenever he comes close to the final solution, that is, to the final encounter with he actually gives up. He doesn't want to get to know what or who V actually is. So it's very interesting that we can look at V as an attempt to abolish the historiography, which is written in the paternalistic vein, and that's why he's using V as the kind of a assemblage of parts, because this assemblage works like Benjamin's allegory. Now, Benjamin's allegory is an allegory in which it's a trope which you employ in writing history, in which the disinherited have voice. It's not a nice and beautiful, smooth out glossed over allegory. It's an allegory which looks more like a collage in which you've got different chunks which are incommensurate. It's so basically, even if a stencil is the representative, is kind of one, is representative of the symbolic at the same time rebelling against the symbolic. V is V. He's after actually sort of represents the effort to write history in a non-paternalistic way. I don't know if it's
this makes sense. Yes, thanks. Yeah, and you know, I mean, this actually kind of leads up to my second question, if that's okay, if I can just go on and ask it now. Which is simply, I don't know that I really kind of grasped your point where you were saying that the Baroque, the Neo-Baroque can be not sort of on the side of the minor literature or the minor strategy, but the, but the dominant.
I suppose it's kind of one of the problems we have in Neo-Baroque is the confusion, terminological confusion. So let me start with kind of the first attempt to sort of organize this confusion. The writers and critics from the field of Latin American studies, they actually decided that one of the best solutions would be Baroque is European, Neo-Baroque is in Europe. That was one solution. But then somebody else came and said, no, Baroque is historical, Neo-Baroque is contemporary. Okay. Then we had somebody who would say that in the Baroque we have got, and in Neo-Baroque we have this minor and major strategy, then Neo-Baroque then is not only intersecting with postmodernity, but you can have different Neo-Baroques, Neo-Baroque minor, Neo-Baroque major. And I suppose as I was in the presentation, I probably took a shortcut. Okay. So what I meant was that what's important for us is understanding that Neo-Baroque is a trans-historical phenomenon. So you can include in Neo-Baroque times, for instance, mannerism. You can include in it Romanticism as well. Okay. Some people say that Romanticism is actually very much Neo-Baroque. I've got a colleague who wrote a book on the Baroque in one of the most important English poets.
Keats, Wordsworth.
No. No, come on, that's funny, it's just like escaping. One of the most important.
Byron,
that's it, yeah. So, Baroque Byron, okay? And it's Romanticism can belong to this too. So, transhistorical, Neo-Baroque, because what's important is not really the time of its appearance, but the aesthetical, formal expression given to the same problems of thought and politics. So how you understand what it means to be real. Okay. And so you have the same problems in Romanticism where you have now. Okay. Now, but this question can be answered in different ways, as I said, that those powers that be prefer the answer which means that behind the veil, of course there is something behind the veil, and this, we have the monopoly on telling you what there is behind the veil. And to show you that we know, we are organizing a spectacle which sort of enlists you to support us. So the powers that be. In the 17th century France, it would be Louis the 14th ballet, okay, which was designed to support the king, etc., etc. Now, a contemporary reality, we have got the entertainment, and not all entertainment, and not all games, for instance, computer games are, for instance, terribly progressive in terms of ideology. Yeah? So, in other words, if you have a minor strategy in aesthetics, which draws your attention to the fact that you are not dealing with the real plenum, the real reality, if I can say so, but with the construction, then this is minor strategy. And this minor strategy can inhabit Neo-Baroque just as well as Baroque. Okay, so in Neo-Baroque, which is contemporary expression of this zeitgeist. Dangerous, but I mean, let's reuse it. Okay. So if we can use it, so you can. You also can have neo-baroque, which is kind of more revolutionary, and neo-baroque, which is less. And for instance, Angela Dalianis, who's book published in 2004, and then Angela Dalianis, an Australian scholar, she actually analyzed computer games, Matrix, films, etc., and contemporary new media in terms of Baroque poetics, but she never thought about differentiating, about checking or sort of analyzing the ideological engagement or investment of particular form. So if you come to think of it, there is a film about, I didn't have time to mention it, and a film by a very young filmmaker, M. Dot Strange. The film is We Are the Strange. Now this film is a kind of a remediation of a computer game. So a film which sort of takes up computer game as the, so it's kind of a anachronistic limitation. And this film is actually through and through minor strategy, because it shows you all the ideological dangers of computer games not being didactic. So in other words, a production which draws attention to its being a production, its being artifice, can be named minor. The production which wants to blur the frames and tell you, no, it's not artifice, this is the reality. Like William Eddington, for instance, in his book, The Theatre of Truth, starts one of the chapters with describing the speeches of Bush, the junior. Again, he shows that this is like Baroque major spectrum. Yeah? And so, so in neo-baroque, contemporary neo-baroque, you can have main, minor, and major strategy as well.
So where does Baudrillard belong to? Where would you place Baudrillard in this spectrum?
Okay, Baudrillard actually, it's very funny, Baudrillard is outside, because Baudrillard is Cartesian, and neo-baroque is Leibnizian. So Leibnizian fold is continuum, not the dichotomy. Okay. And so Baudrillard is interested in dichotomy of the embodied and the sign, etc., matrix and reality. Whereas more contemporary specialists in the media and digital media, they are interested in thinking about the ensemble of me in front of my computer in the, and the game, reality of the game, is one fold. So it's a continuum. So Baudrillard is, but his observations are used by the neo-baroque critics, right, because they are absolutely valid. It's simply a different way of looking at how you can explain the relationship between bodies, so materiality and immateriality, without referring to metaphysics. Does that answer your question? It's, of course, there are different discussions, and for instance, Anne Munster is great because she says, well, we should, when we juxtapose Cartesian, so Baudrillardian understanding of electronic reality and the like Nietzschean, then we do the same. We are recreating the same division, the same Cartesian division. So she is postulating going beyond the division. So in other words, with Anne Munster, she's inviting Baudrillard into the fold, if I can say so, okay, of the understanding of reality as a fold. So going beyond even the division between Cartesian and non-Cartesian. It's becoming kind of more of a complex, just like the idea of the fold the rest presenting, dividing into smaller and smaller folds into infinity. Looks like a fractal in mathematics. Does this answer me?
Yeah, thank you.
So can I just sum up? So I understand that the way you think about this, it's a neo-baroque is a aesthetic mode phenomenon that can take on various ideological balances depending on its uses.
Okay. Yeah, that's
right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay.
That's exactly.
And that's why we can have, that's why chronology doesn't really matter, because it's like not a question, because it may be used to different aims in different periods. When I hear transhistorical, then I want to ask, can we imagine neo-Baroque before the Baroque?
Yes, absolutely, right? Yeah, we can. It's simply the historical Baroque is a point of reference because we are used to, it was, it's just like with the Iberian trace. It's the first thing we actually happen to stumble upon. That is, we know historical Baroque, that's why we have a point of departure, a point of comparison. Mm-hmm. But if we forgot about historical Baroque, then we would be talking about certain ways, certain structures of thought, which find their realization. Thought and practice, so thought and practice are realized in certain aesthetical forms. Yeah? And so we don't have to mention it in Baroque, but simply we mention Baroque because we know Baroque, because the history of art familiarized us with this historical label, so we use it. But we could just as well invite somebody from the Mars and show them, just like, we don't talk about Baroque at all, we talk about certain structures which find expression in other structures. Does it make sense? And so, just going back to the minor and major, there is one, so different valences. There's one danger, like with everything, that capitalism can co-opt everything. And so you remember, I remember just when I was in school, the Johnny Rotten, the Sex Pistols, my colleagues kind of getting all kinds of, all the safety pins they could collect from their grandmothers, whatever. But nowadays, everybody is wearing outfits which were believed to be completely alternative and revolutionary. They have been co-opted. So the same can happen to the minor strategy. Minor strategy can fossilize and become major strategy. So it can happen. So what's important for minor strategy, and I suppose I haven't mentioned it, that it should be in constant movement. If something doesn't move, it dies. So basically, minor strategy it consists in, that's what Monica Koch says, it's becoming minor. If it is minor, it's dead. So it has to be, and of course, when we are talking, when there's a presentation, it's very difficult to put your finger on the thing which is in constant movement. Yeah? So you dissect, and when you dissect, something stops moving. But the idea is that as long as the artists, politicians, whoever is interested in blowing up the major strategies representations, then it is minor strategy. But the moment it's co-opted, and very often it happens that the alternative is co-opted and it sells very well. No, it's not alternative anymore. You need another, somebody who would actually do the reverse. Maybe they would go back to what was before major, but that major would be mine. I think it's kind of, it's expressed really brilliantly in, is it Django? Maybe it's not Django. I break out of my tradition, my family tradition, and I stop breaking out of the family tradition. That's kind of, in other words, it's absurd movement. In minor strategy, simply, uses absurd movements. I don't know how many of you heard about the Orange Alternative, the political movement in the which started in the early 1980s. And they were an authentic minor strategy because they met the communist regime with absurd aesthetics. They were not politically combatant politics. Nothing wrong, probably, with combat politics, but their politics was aesthetic politics, and it was a completely paradoxical. The authorities and the law enforcement didn't know what to do when they were facing them, because it was so new, and they were using everything they had at hand, so they were bringing to their meetings rolls of paper, toilet paper. They were approaching the policemen, saying, "Well, today is the day of friendship with police, and now, let's smile." And the policemen were going to be Litia. Okay, they were completely stunned. Now, the Orange Alternative was a real minor strategy. they were not using any different language than language which they found in the street and in the ideological discourses, but they turned it into absurd response, and it was beautiful. I mean, they were beautiful in aesthetic terms. So that's I mean about the valence, which is the valence can change. Yeah. So in fact, this makes it so political because you have to be all the time on your guard. Yeah? Because if you fall asleep, then it may be that your minor strategy is not minor anymore. So it's minor strategy is really very political. Even if it does not shout me in politics so much, but it's very very political.
Because it goes against the grain of the dominant. That's true.
Exactly, but it doesn't.
But there's something else that you.
But it doesn't go against in the sense of bringing something new to the equation. It simply uses what's already in the equation. That's why it's so dangerous. It manipulates the same elements, but in a different way, amplifying. Parody is again one of the measures it works.
I have one question. When you had this book library,
okay, you can go
back
to it.
I really enjoyed one of them, or a few of them, were talking about the neo-baroque in the digital age.
This is.
Could you comment on this?
Oh, okay.
How does it inform?
The best one here, digital baroque, Mario's digital baroque, is actually about how the digital media, they are so conducive to bringing back the thought of historical baroque. He's used, I mean, the Marek's kind of interested in the contemporary art. He's showing, he's interested in installations, video art, whatever he wrote of the book. The book consists of the articles he wrote over the years, so he was interested in video installations, whatever. But he always shows that there is what's interesting for in the digital baroque is conscious relationship between the immaterial and material, the electronic impulse code and the body, the material, the body. So installations, the projections of on the body, I mean, just of images, but also a very interesting connection of the computer program, which is hooked up to an organism, which is kind of doing performing some activities, and then the program is recording those activities by encrypting it. So the resulting work of art, because it can sort of be encrypting in terms of color, line, whatever, the resulting image, the resulting work, okay, is a work of art. So it's kind of a literal hooking up of the body, of the organic body, through the machine to the work of art. So that's another possibility. There are different. What else? Peter Greenaway's installations are discussed here. By Marie. Marie actually started with it as a scholar concerned with the French 17th century. So he really knows his Baroque, I mean historical Baroque very well. And then he went on to Lacanian in analysis, and then he ended up in digital Baroque. Then there's something which is kind of really very interesting and sort of connects to the to my forensic interest. Visualizing law in the age of the digital baroque. This is kind of it's a serious book on legal matters. It's about the so-called CSI effect. That is the effect of the crime scene investigation programs. That the CSI effect is that in court, it's only the images and like in the lab, we know from the CSI programs, count for the jury. The jury doesn't want to deliberate; they want to have the solution sort of proposed to them through the by the representatives of the crime laboratories, and they want to have the certain pieces of evidence shown instead of having it kind of presented in physically, which according to those images that they absolutely change the scene, because they they generate very many philosophical questions which the public is not really is oblivious of. Okay, and so this effect is called by the author Richard Sherman the effect of neo-baroque proliferation of images and how it has influenced the court proceedings. And they are really changing. And I don't want to go into the kind of more specific kind of theoretical deliberations, but it's very interesting that the term neo-baroque is very important because it explains what's going on, what are the changes in the system of law. Now, I think it's also very interesting, when I was preparing for this presentation, I went into some of the, into a database, and what I got was baroque in chemistry, and I was just like, what the hell? Is it about the historical chemistry or alchemy? No, it was actually about a phenomenon in which certain chemical processes cannot be described linearly. When they are described non-linearly, they are called baroque effects or whatever. So baroque and neo-baroque is important because it explains questions we can, or problems we can have in scholarship and in research. I suppose what's also interesting is kind of beautiful field in Cervantes. This is a beautiful picture from referring to Romeo and Juliet. What's his name? What's his face? I don't know if you remember the Romeo and Juliet in contemporary Las Vegas. It's kind of old film, but it still has got traction because it's so media packed. Yeah. And so the guy who's the author is kind of interested in such media representations. He devoted quite a lot of space in the book to the Matrix and its spin-offs and whatever. It's kind of very interesting discussion. And I think just like what's also very important, now this is different because it has nothing to do with media. Baroque New World, this is an anthology which actually is basic for anybody who's interested in neo-baroque or the New World Baroque. It's by Monica Kaup and it's an anthology edited by Monica Kaup and Lois Parkinson Zamora. And they actually had translated all the most important texts about Baroque, Neo-Baroque, New World Baroque. So when I started my research, most of those texts, I had to go into some obscure publications. Now they are all in one anthology. The anthology was published in 2010. It's a brilliant anthology, and also it's beautiful because it refers to the name Baroque, I mean Barocco, which kind of, whenever you talk about Baroque, everybody starts with a name and says, mentions this irregular pearl, etc. Now what they do is, they say that when you look at the Baroque New World, the New World Baroque, Baroque and Neo-Baroque, then actually there is no, they are not discrete terms. Okay? So it's not impossible to separate those phenomena, but you can think of them in a Baroque way, metaphorically, as all creating such an irregular pearl. So they are all kind of diffused on the surface of this irregular pearl. So it's a beautiful image in the introduction to this anthology. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.